Thank you, everyone, for joining me here in my home in this strange and difficult time. I'll come to COVID-19, but I want to start with something else. And with the risk of sounding a bit pretentious, I'm going to like to start with a parable from Franz Kafka. There's a man, happy, minding his own business, who sees an open gate in the corner of the room where he is. He approaches the gate and wonders where it leads to. But as he approaches the gate, he sees that it's being guarded. The guard looks powerful from a distance, but up close appears quite unkempt. And the guard warns the man that through this gate is only another gate with a guard who's even more powerful. So the man backs away, spends his days, which turn into decades, in the room, just occasionally wondering about that gate and where it might lead to. Eventually, when the man is weak and old, he knows his own death is near, he realizes what he should have asked the guard. So he shuffles back and says to the guard, "In all the time I've been in this room, why has nobody ever been through that gate?" The guard sees that the man is old and bellows back to him, "Because this gate was only meant for you, but it's too late now." It was written in 1914 by Franz Kafka, and like any great allegory, it works in many ways. It's particularly inspiring to me in at least two ways. Firstly, as a scientist, it's my job to walk through gates where no one has been before. Secondly, the story is also about the uniqueness of each of us, the paths we have in life. And as well as that, it speaks to me about the fact that we're unique right down to the molecular details of what we're made of. Now, what is it, in fact, that makes each of us different? Well, one thing, of course, is our genes. And each of us have inherited around 23,000 genes that make up the human genome. And roughly speaking, these genes are the same between you and me. About 0.1% of our genes are different. And if you think, well, what are the genes that make me different from other people? You might think it might include genes that influence our hair color, eye color, skin color. But something that we've learned from studying the immune system is that, in fact, the genes that vary the most between me and you and everybody else are our immune system genes. If you and I are infected with a version of flu, for example, you might recover in 3 days, I might recover in 4 days. And one of the reasons for that would be that we have different versions of immune system genes. So the most important thing, though, is that there's no hierarchy in this system, the diversity in our immune system genes. So if we're infected with a different virus, then I might recover in 3 days and you might recover in 4 days. The system works by keeping this great diversity, which protects each of us from all the different possible diseases that could exist. So that overall, the diversity of humanity is most acutely seen in immune system genes. And the reason for that is to protect us from disease. So it's not just merely poetry to celebrate or praise human diversity. There's a really fundamental importance to why we're all a bit different, which is to protect us against disease. And for me, that is profoundly important because the great tragedies in history, from the Holocaust to the slave trade, have come about from misunderstanding the differences between people. And from studying the immune system, then one of the really surprising things is that human diversity is deeply, profoundly important for how we survive disease. Now, there's another reason why, of course, studying the immune system is really important to me, which is that it's about also trying to make new medicines. And I only have a time to just give you one example of where that is. And when you're infected with flu, then the cells in your body that fight off that flu virus multiply a number and your body goes into a heightened state to kill off the virus. But when the virus has been eradicated from your body, then your body has to sort of come back to its normal level. You don't need all those numbers of cells fighting that particular flu virus. So your immune system has breaks within it to switch itself off after some time. And that was discovered simply through curiosity-driven research, working out how the immune system works. But from that basic understanding of how the system works leads us to an idea for medicine. Because if the breaks come on in the immune system when you're fighting after you've fought off the flu virus, that seems good. That's a good thing to happen. But if the breaks come on while your body is trying to fight something that's much more long-term, like cancer, then that seems like a bad idea and it might weaken your ability to fight off cancer. So that has led to new kinds of medicines which block the breaks on the immune system as a way of boosting its power to fight off something like cancer. And for some types of cancer, for some patients, these types of medicines have made a huge difference. The reason that we're at a particularly exciting moment is that from all the detailed understanding of the immune system, we've got to a point where there are lots of big new ideas about medicines that could harness the power of the immune system to fight off different kinds of disease. Even within that one example I gave you of blocking breaks on the immune system to make it fight better, the drugs that we currently use only block two particular breaks on the immune system. But the system is full of all different kinds of cells, an elaborate network, or a complicated system. And there are at least 20 different breaks on different parts of it. So that means we can try blocking different breaks, either on their own or in combination, to tackle different kinds of disease, to boost the power of the immune system in different subtle ways to fight off different kinds of disease. And all in all, from our deep understanding of how the system works, we really are at the point where there are many ideas for ways in which we can nudge the power of the immune system up for fighting cancer, for example, or dampen it to help fight off immune disease, for example. And so I think it's genuinely true that we're at the cusp of lots of new kinds of medicines coming through over the next years to come. But of course, there's also COVID-19. And the arrival of COVID-19 has given us, you know, shifted the world in many ways. There's much to be learned from its arrival, where the virus come from, the way germs spread throughout the world, the impact of different countries' response to the virus, how the global lockdown affects businesses, our family life, and the way we live, our personal feelings. There's so much to be learned. And of course, it's a great tragedy, but also there are some positives. We've learned that the world is really full of people that we must pay more attention to. Obviously, healthcare workers, but also bin collectors, postal service workers, cleaners. So there are some important things that we're learning from the virus, the arrival of this virus, that are really important for society going forward. But also, if there's one aspect of the human body which has moved center stage in the way that we're going to tackle this virus, it is understanding the immune system more. And there are a huge number of crucial questions which were being tackled by scientists, but even more now are right bang in the frontier of what's really important for us to do for humanity. For example, we need to understand what really is the differences between the immune system of young, middle-aged and elderly people, because we know that the virus causes worse symptoms in the elderly. We need to understand exactly what makes a good memory immune response. There are gaps in our knowledge about really what it is that helps the immune system fight off the virus better a second time round. We know roughly how that process works, but we still don't have a really clear understanding of what it takes to make a strong, long-lived immune protective response that might last for some years. And that's obviously a crucial thing that we need to understand, not least for vaccines going forward. And coming back to the very first point I made, we need to understand the differences between people, in that it's very likely that there'll be also some genetic contribution to how we each fare with this particular virus, as well as the history of infections we've previously had. And understanding the uniqueness we all have in our immune system and how that plays out, this particular virus and other diseases is also a vital new frontier. So all in all, you know, I'm just one person out of a community of many tens of thousands of people trying to understand how this wondrous part of the human body works. And it's a very exciting time because there's really big, important questions that are truly fascinating to understand. Thanks.